Rose-colored glasses are off. It's time to get real. Yet, we remain hopeful still. This is the Marketing Disenchanted Podcast. I am your host, Temitayo Osinubi. Let's get to it. Welcome to episode 44 of the Marketing Disenchanted Podcast. I am once again Temitayo Osinubi, your number one resource to teach you the reality of the digital marketing landscape to propel your career. This week, I had the delight of chatting with the leader in the trenches himself, Mr. Gene Hammett. Gene Hammett turns everyday entrepreneurs into forces of nature in their markets. He sorts through the complexities of business strategies to help them be the choice instead of just a choice. Gene has been a business leader for over 20 years. He started and ran multiple $1 million companies responsible for over $30 million in sales. He succeeded, failed, reinvented himself, and succeeded again. On his podcast, Leaders in the Trenches, Gene has interviewed hundreds of world thought leaders and best-selling New York Times authors. Gene has been featured in Forbes, Success Magazine, Business Insider, and Inc. Magazine. Gene is also a regular contributor to Entrepreneur Magazine. So without further ado, let's get into our interview with Gene Hammett. Gene, thanks so much for joining me.
I'm excited to be here.
Awesome. So I first met you at Sage Summit. You were on the big stage. You were nicely coordinated with the jacket down to the socks. I appreciate details like that. And you are a business leader who talks about leadership and has a background in marketing. But nobody starts at the top. Nobody starts out, you know, on the big stage. Everybody has to start somewhere. So tell us that story. Take us on that journey. When did you first get bit by the bug? And how did you become enchanted with leadership and marketing?
I appreciate you remembering the socks, because I remember you tweeting about it. So thanks. And I got a lot of compliments on that blue jacket. That was a fun day.
It was amazing.
Well, you know, enchanted by the bug here of leadership and marketing. I got into business in 2001. I'd spent about 10 years in corporate America, and I knew that I wanted to be, I was an entrepreneur at heart, but I was getting skills and really just trying to find that idea to come up with something. And the dot-com rush had already started and then had also fall down. And so I knew that right after 9/11, getting laid off would be a great time to start a business. I mean, what else would I going to do? No one was hiring. So I started a business doing something I had done previously, like through my life, which was selling tickets and concerts and sporting events. The online world was just starting to blow up, and I really was kind of excited because I put up a website, and within literally hours, I want to say it's within 6 hours, I started getting orders. That's pretty cool, isn't it?
That's amazing.
But that also has to happen when there wasn't that many people selling online, and there were some advantages to doing it that way. There's no tricks to that, but I was getting orders for inventory that I had where I just put it up on the line and someone else already had the customer and so on and so forth. And I was selling my inventory for the price I wanted. So I ran that business for 9 years. And what I learned in doing that, you know, I was in the trenches, because that's the name of my podcast, Leaders in the Trenches, was you really wanted to stand out from others. You didn't want to be just like everyone else, because that's the path to competing on price. And when you're selling something where it could be compared on price, you want to be very careful about how you build and establish that business. At least I thought that through. And so I started making some major changes inside my business, and it started working really well. And I focused my business. I think the first year I was online, I was doing probably over 600 different events. And yes, I know there's more than that's more than one per day, but it led to a heartache and a lot of stress. And so I really learned to focus my business to about 6 core events. I worked on them longer and harder than anyone I know of, because I didn't really distract myself with all these other things. And it positioned me as a leader in that market. And that's where I really first started the bug and that business. There's a big story after that, but I just kind of stop right there.
600 events. My God, that's a dizzying pace. So I think you kind of started to go into it, but when did you become disenchanted? When was the honeymoon over? Because it's sort of like marriage, right? You first get started, everything's new and different. Then you find out this person snores like a dying moose and has all these other quirks. So when did it get real for you?
You know, as I began to make more money, it got to be real in a way that I was like, oh, I'm making more money than I've ever made. I was making more money than my parents, more money than my wife's parents. And, you know, everyone looked at me like, who is this kid that travels around the world and makes hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of thousands of dollars doing this thing called tickets? And I just wasn't happy, though. I mean, even though I had money, I had freedom. I looked at what I was doing as just a way to make money. And so there was something missing inside me. So there was some purpose and some level of potential that I wasn't realizing. Now, I say that because really looking back at that from where I am now, I realize what was missing. I was just making more money and I needed to be doing something where I really make an impact. And I get to make an impact every day. Just minutes ago, I got off the phone call with a client I've been working with for about 3 years. He's got a great opportunity coming up. He needed 15 minutes to just frame in like this next opportunity to address this audience of like 100 of his perfect clients. And so we're able to do that very quickly and have a huge impact to his business, like a profound impact to his business when he nails this. And he will nail it because I'm going to ensure that he does and he's ready for it.
That's amazing.
I get to do that, right? Before, I just made money. Before, I just made, created a new relationship. And it really was draining on me energy-wise, but also just something was missing inside me. And I wasn't really able to express my soul. Is that too touchy-feely for you, Timmy?
No, it makes perfect sense to me because, I mean, you have to have a reason to do what you're doing or else you're just going to stop.
Well, I kept doing it. That's the problem that I did have. And I told you that, you know, getting that business, there's kind of a story there. I'll share it with you now. But I was in the business, not necessarily happy, but making a lot of money. And I had a big opportunity that I worked on for the Beijing Olympics. I had about 7,000 customers plus. I got tired of counting how many customers I had, but 7,000 customers in Beijing. I made over $1.2 million in 7 weeks.
Wow. That's
profit. That's not sales. That's profit.
My God.
And I was crushing the business, but I still wasn't happy. Like, I was the big man and I was doing all this stuff, traveling the world. I had freedom, but I wanted to do more. And so I put together the next big deal. And my wife kept asking me this question. And you know, bless her heart, she stuck with me through all this. But she said, you know, why don't you do something else? I'm like, do you realize how much money we make? Like, I don't want to give this up. And I don't want to give up my freedom. And she's like, yeah, but you can do something else. And I'm like, well, when I can, you know, I think I said the words, when I figure out another business and replace this income, I'll stop doing tickets or I'll sell the business. And it's just the way I saw the world. And, you know, I look back at that. I was trapped by my own success, being unhappy, but yet continuing to do the same things I wanted to do, even though I had money and I had all this so-called, you know, freedom. Like, I've got this huge thing that just happened in my life and, you know, something's facing me. Well, in 2010, I had another big deal. It was a little over $1 million invested, and that deal continued to grow. I had about $3 million on the line. And I had over 10,000 customers depending on me for the Vancouver Olympics. Remember, I said I work one event bigger and better than anyone. Well, I've been working on this for a while. And my best friend, partner on this, in air quotes, ended up keeping the money. He never paid up. He never inventory, never refunded me. And I ended up, my business imploded. I just fell to a sickening low and I had to lose everything and rebuild my life from that point.
Oh, that's crushing.
But to, you know, fast forward through that, I ended up finding a, you know, that I'm going to supposed to be a coach. And there's a, you know, there's a big kind of story inside there, but I found where my purpose was. I found where I really was meant to serve this world. And I'm really excited about what I do day in and day out. It's not easy, but I get to do it and I get to make such a difference with people.
This is deep waters, my friend, deep, deep waters. So if you had a time machine, you could go back and talk to your younger self, you know, without causing any paradoxes or cataclysms to the space-time continuum. Yes, I watch Doctor Who. What are the top three things you would tell your younger self to help prepare for your journey?
I've always tried to live my life without regrets. And I know I wouldn't be where I am if I didn't lose everything. But I would, you know, if I could, if, you know, without, you know, sending the world into some never-ending, you know, wormhole or twist, I would say, you know, be more careful with the way I set my business up, for sure, because I ended up doing personal bankruptcy. I guaranteed those loans personally. And so when I had to do bankruptcy, I had to bankrupt myself, not just the company. And that's hard. Like that really did have an impact on my own confidence and my own, you know, kind of growth. And it's something that hung over my head for about 5 years.
Wow, that's tough. And thank you for sharing that. Like, without getting too personal, like, how did that affect your relationships with your wife and everyone else? Because I've gone through a rough patch where I've had my you know, my confidence shaken, and that's hard, not only for you, but for everybody around you.
Yeah, it is. You know, there's a few people that were really involved with this, and so I'll kind of give you answer that question in such a way that hopefully shines a light on it for everyone else. My wife really leaned into me. She literally said, look, we're going to do this together. We're going to get back. We're going to, you know, this is, we're going to be fine. And so that was really a great time for that, because one of the first things I thought, I had a 2.5-year-old son at the time, who's now 10, said, you know, I thought she would just leave me and I would just be with nothing. And it really scared me. But she rest assured and she stuck with me. You know, it got worse before it got better. Like, once you realize something like that's going to happen, that's not the low. The low was like weeks and weeks into that, when you didn't want to get out of bed and you realize there's no money coming in and you don't even have prospects for money coming in, and, you know, debtors and all of this stuff was just like pressuring us. We lost the house. We lost that business, of course. The relationship with her got better. Now, come back to that. The relationship with my son got infinitely better, because I realized that I wanted to focus on things that could never be ripped away from me, because I lost everything that day. And so I focused on, you know, me being the best dad I could be. And it's something I was probably not doing a very good job before this happened, if I can be honest with you guys. And then there's all those other people that were friends and, you know, really kind of close associates. You really get, when something like that happens, you get to figure out who really does care for you and love for you and who is not. And it was a tough time, because my attorneys told me I couldn't talk about it. And so I couldn't talk about it for months and months and months. And so it was really dark. After that, you know, some of those people ended up washing away. They never were really friends, is what I see now. But the ones that did show themselves to me through all this, and even some of the people I met after that, because I've shared this story, you know, after that, from stages and through my book that's coming out, it really has, you know, strengthened a lot of those relationships. I told you I'd come back to my wife. It's been a long road after that, because we've both got an entrepreneurial kind of bent on life. In 7 years of getting that together, and now that we're successful, we're not as successful as we were. So it's still hard. And it's been hard on both of us, because we have two separate businesses that we're running, and it's been really hard to rebuild from that period. And I'm not trying to say that I guess I'd love to be able to tell the stories like, this happened one day and like 6 months later and I was back on top again. But that wasn't what happened. Like, I spent years really doubting myself and really trying to build myself back up, knowing that I could do this. And I'm glad I did, because the resolve that I have and the grit that's developed is unlike anything I've ever seen before in myself. And that's necessary for my growth going forward.
thank you for sharing that. Those are deep waters, my friend. Deep, deep waters. So now I'm going to actually look into the future, because one of the areas of marketing that I focus on is mobile / connected devices / Internet of Things. And sort of the default example that everyone gives is the smart refrigerator that knows when you're out of milk and automatically adds it to your shopping list, which is then delivered to you via Amazon drone. And in that scenario, that's what they call a closed loop system, because you don't actually have to leave the house. Like, everything's automated, kind of like the Jetsons. And so given your background in marketing, especially in leadership, what do you see the role of marketing and leadership being in that future when everything is, you know, automated to the nth degree? Because there are some people who are concerned, like, okay, are we all going to have jobs? Like, is this going to be the next iteration of the assembly line? And now we're all out of work and we're taking orders from a robot. Like, what's your take on that whole future scenario?
You know, I don't have the crystal ball, but I can tell you that I believe technology will continuously evolve, that the way we interact with our laptops, the way we interact with our phones will continuously evolve. I really do believe that, you know, what you described and you know, pulling out that last item out of the refrigerator and it showing up the next day or the next hour, that'll be here. I think that to get there, there'll be a lot of opportunities for the companies that are insanely expert in certain areas of that supply chain. This is one of the things I believe from a leadership perspective, and if you combine leadership and marketing, I really help customers or companies become experts or leaders in their own category. I do work with companies that are in the development area and in the marketing area, but they are really hyper-focused. When they're generating and growing their business, that level of hyper-focus is something I will see continuing through the evolution of all of our technology. You know, it takes, you know, it won't be just Amazon that's involved with all pieces of that thing you just described. There's a lot of other people that are involved. Who's developing the Internet of Things in the home based? What integration points are they across the system? And who is managing the data and who is making smart decisions based on all that? There'll be individual companies and opportunities inside there that all the people, you know, all the jobs that will be lost because of robots and computers, there'll be new opportunities if you're willing to step into those levels.
I tend to agree because, you know, the economy goes on. I mean, yes, you had some people lose their jobs with the invention of the assembly line, but on the whole, the economy got stronger and the automobile became less expensive. And you could say the same thing about websites like, you know, Expedia and Travelocity. Yes, that put a lot of travel agents out of business, but on the whole, the travel experience is better and the economy is stronger. So you speak at a lot of marquee events. And so you, Gary Vee, and Jay Baer, or insert whichever thought leader, if you happen to be at a different conference, Brian Solis, whoever, you're all chilling at the bar after the conference, having a straight talk, no BS mini mastermind. What would you say is severely lacking from the professional digital marketing industry? And how would you brainstorm about correcting it?
The digital marketing industry, I think there's not enough people that are truly focused on results. I work with a lot of digital marketing companies and I've given speeches on the need to track results. And most of the time they come back in digital marketing, it's like, well, that's hard. And I've heard Gary Vee talk about different things about tracking the ROI of social media and tracking the ROI of your mother and whatnot. But still, at the end of the day, all of the money being spent on digital marketing has to create some type of return.
Right.
There are certain elements that are around awareness. There's certain elements around direct response. There's certain elements that tied directly and indirectly to transactions and things like that. But I think there's a real serious need for people to track all elements of digital marketing so that we know what's working and how do we refine those things over time. And I think that the ones that are best at doing that won't be, you know, full service, quote unquote, agencies. They'll be the ones that are real experts that understand the finest minutiae that are necessary to get return. And those are the ones that I think will want to work with, spend their money on this. And a lot of this comes from my years of running a business and hiring digital marketing companies where they were big on promises and short on delivery.
Absolutely. Drew McClellan over at the Agency Management Institute, he publishes a report every year, and he cited a figure that he interviewed businesses that have between $500,000 and $4 million in ad spend. 34% of the time they fired their agencies because they didn't get what they paid for. Like you said, these people were faking the funk. And so you definitely are going to see the rise of some specialists who can, produce results and have that attribution. So last year in 2016, myself and my co-author, we wrote a book called Beyond Buzzwords. And by far the buzzword of 2016 was influencer marketing. Like, it wasn't even close. You had all these articles and podcasts popping up about influencer marketing, and those in the space warned that it was only a matter of time before we got a spectacular train wreck. Not just a regular train wreck, but a spectacular train wreck. I'm talking about mushroom cloud, debris everywhere. And we've already had a few examples this year. You had Pepsi and Kendall Jenner try to profit off of the social unrest in a very ham-fisted way. But my favorite by far is courtesy of none other than one PewDiePie. So for those who don't know, PewDiePie is the original rags to riches YouTube success story. He went from just a guy to having about $4 million in revenue from his YouTube channel. He was the first YouTube channel with a billion views on YouTube. And he previously had relationships with Disney and Maker. And the reason I say previously is because PewDiePie fashions himself as an amateur humorist. And he decided to take shots at the website Fiverr and all the outrageous things you can get people to do for as little as $5. The problem is, the way in which he chose to go about this was by hiring people to say and do anti-Semitic things. And of course, the fallout was swift and immediate. However, Disney actually got a fair amount of backlash from PewDiePie's followers for abandoning him, because Chris Brogan made a very salient point on the Marketing Companion podcast with Tom Webster and Mark Schaefer that the way that younger millennials and digital natives use language is very different from the way that older generations use language. And what offends us does not necessarily offend them. So my question to you is, do you think that this, fiasco with PewDiePie is going to embolden those seeking to, secure their 15 minutes of fame and don't necessarily have the, same level of sensitivity to other generations like baby boomers and Gen Xers? Or do you think that, this will be a wake up call to businesses to actually do their homework before they treat influencer marketing like just another media buy? Because if you knew anything about PewDiePie, you know that he tends to push the envelope.
And that's probably one reason why he's amassed the following that he has, right? He's on the edge.
Right.
I think that it'll be definitely being more careful, doing the homework and really researching these influencers. There's a lot of, like, the one story that I remember is Scott Disick was on social media or something and said, hey, someone gave him a quote or something to put in Twitter, and he actually just copied and pasted it. And it actually had like, copy and paste this here.
Oh, wow.
Right.
Right.
And just, it's not that big of a deal. Like, it's such a minor thing, but it wasn't the first time he's done this. It probably won't be the last, but he just you want to make sure that if you're looking at influencers, that you're attaching your brand to someone who really will respect the values of your company. And so that's one reason why, the research will be much more important. But I don't think influencer marketing will go away. But I think companies that are looking to use that channel will be more careful in who they attach themselves to.
I certainly hope so. So we are going to take a short break, and then when we get back, we're going to dive deeper with Gene Hammett. So stick with me. We've all heard the stories. New mom starts a blog while on maternity leave, and now she's a multimillionaire. Or the pizza boy with just a GED who now makes more than all of his teachers combined. Or that one guy that got stricken with some calamity that left him bedridden for 6 months or something like that. You get my point. insert cliche here. They would all have you believe it's as simple as getting online, finding success, and living happily ever after. Rinse and repeat. And eternal optimist that you are, you think, why not me? And you fall for it. Hook, line, and sinker. You quickly find yourself completely overwhelmed with digital business operations, disappointed, and ultimately disenchanted with the whole online success fairy tale. Well, friends, you're not alone. Now, I can hear the groans of objection now. You're just being negative. Those stories are real. That really happens to people. And yeah, that has been known to happen. And people have also been known to win the lottery or marry their high school sweetheart after falling in love at first sight. But then you have the rest of us. Those stories often leave out the lucky breaks, support systems, and hard skills needed to truly achieve success online. I don't. Through the Marketing Disenchanted podcast, I've connected you with top thought leaders and real online professionals, not outliers who don't recognize themselves as such. Through these candid, no BS conversations, we discuss what it's really like to achieve success online and give you the tools and strategies to do the same. Did you know I'm also available to you for speaking engagements, digital discernment workshops, and even one-on-one Skype or telephone consults? Go to consulttemi.com and book me for your next event. That's consulttemi.com and click on the speaking tab. You see, being a real digital marketing professional doesn't have to be a pipe dream left unfulfilled, but you gotta take the rose-colored glasses off and get real. So go to consulttemi.com to book me, and I look forward to seeing you in person. And remember, tactics change, but principles don't. So don't get bewitched by the shiny ball syndrome. See you soon. And we're back. So, Gene, without getting political, staying more so on the marketing side of things, what's your take on the fake news fallout / controversy after the 2016 U.S. presidential election? And just to back up for those who may not know, in the last 3 months of the 2016 U.S. presidential election, fake news began to outperform real news on Facebook. And by fake news, I mean these stories were wholesale fabricated, had no factual basis in reality whatsoever. It was not a simple matter of spinning the facts one direction or another, which all news does. MSNBC leans left, Fox News lean right. There was no underlying facts to be spun, like these were fairy tales. And after the results came out, Mark Zuckerberg sort of played it off and was like, no, it is highly unlikely that Facebook had anything to do with the outcome of the election. However, in his February 2017 open letter, he conceded that fake news has outstripped Facebook's capacity to govern it, and they are in the process of rolling out AI, which is artificial intelligence, and other third-party means to try to curb fake news on their platform. And this has sparked a very interesting debate in the marketing community, because you have some who are strictly First Amendment who are like, no, Facebook is a platform only. They don't have any business trying to be the arbiters of truth. And then you have others who are like, Facebook is a digital property. And as a property owner, you are ultimately responsible for what goes on your property. It's no different than some knucklehead teenagers hop your fence so they can go skinny dipping in your pool and one of them drowns. You put up a fence. They were trespassing. It doesn't matter. It happened on your property and you are responsible. So again, without getting political, you know, to the best of your ability, but by all means, express yourself, because, you know, candor is the whole point of the podcast. What's your take on the whole fake news fallout and Facebook's response to it?
I'm going to say this with a smile, but we shouldn't be getting our news off Facebook. I just, you know, maybe we can comment on certain things, but, you know, if that's your source of news, like, maybe you need to actually turn on and read something of real value out in the market. I noticed that through that election, and I noticed that it was something that a lot of people were talking about, the fake news. And I really do believe that Facebook has a responsibility to have the right content on the platforms. I mean, they're controlling real content, right? They control what we can see, and no one really gets to really complain about that. right? Because the reach of our organic posts and all the things that we're creating, whether they be videos or images or just, you know, text, is 8%, in some case less. They control that. Why shouldn't they be able to control what is considered untruthful and fake news? That's my two cents.
Yeah, very succinct. And I tend to agree, because it's a pickle. And it's like, but to your point, like they clearly have a handle on everything else. And it's like, all of a sudden you can't handle this, that, you know, that does tend to raise the eyebrow. So I'm really interested in your response to this next question, given, you know, how you coach and consult smaller businesses, because large corporations are just now really getting serious about digital marketing. And by that, I mean, now they actually have positions in the company and departments, whereas as recently as a few years ago, you didn't even see that. Everything was outsourced to an agency. And so what's been happening is that these large corporations are dumping their elephant dollars into the ecosystem, and it has been disproportionately going toward Facebook and Google. Like, it's not even close. Just those two entities alone, they're gobbling up like 85, 90 cents of every dollar spent on digital ad spend. And of course, the laws of supply and demand dictate that as you have more competition for a limited amount of ad inventory, that the price for those clicks are going to rise. And we have seen the clicks become more expensive over time. There's a lot of data on it from eMarketer and WordStream. And so what could theoretically happen in the future is that at some point, digital marketing becomes less viable for smaller businesses. And so given the fact that, you know, I know you were really big at one point, but you're rebuilding, given the fact that, you know, you have to now compete in the same ecosystem as, you know, Coca-Cola, and you're throwing around these big dollars, how do you advise your clients, and do you see a future where, you know, every other post is going to be brought to you by Coke, or do you think that the internet will stay true to its disruptive roots, and as that happens, you know, we'll figure out some other guerrilla tactics?
I think if brands like Coca-Cola have an opportunity to attach themselves to content that is being produced and being shared and whatnot, then we'll definitely see those things. Because here's the truth, and this is what I think the truth is. It is getting much more difficult to get the attention of the people we want the attention of. And that's one reason why the level of content needs to actually be worth sharing. So there's a lot of stuff out there that is completely mindless, right? It's not really of value to anyone. It doesn't add entertainment. It doesn't add anything. It actually drains energy from people. And we're tuning that stuff out. And as we're tuning that out, other things have to take its place. What takes its place? Better produced content. You've seen some of the, you know, you're a podcaster, I'm a podcaster. It's hard to look at and not be just enamored with what's going on with like Startup and Serial, right, and some of those really highly produced podcasts that it costs them thousands and thousands and thousands of dollars, maybe $50,000 per episode to create. Who's going to sponsor that for us?
Right.
I think that that's definitely something that will be available, but I don't think it will be everything, because there'll always be a disruptive nature to what's new. It's changing. It's going to be hard for those brands to attach themselves to the emerging superstars. And our job, you know, as a coach, is to find, you know, one of the taglines I use in my business is turning everyday entrepreneurs into forces of nature.
I love that, by the way.
Good. It really is about you being a force of nature within your business, so that you're making a bigger impact in the world and a bigger impact for your clients, and that you have the confidence to do that and to be disruptive. And because it does take confidence to be disruptive. You don't get to do that by being meek. So I think it will continue to evolve, but I think brands will find a way to play, and that brought to you by Starbucks and Six Flags. I really think it will start to emerge even more, because it will offset some of the cost it takes to produce high level content that is going to be necessary. Like TV quality content will be normal for a lot of emerging brands.
That's some very sage insight. No pun intended from the Sage Summit, but you're correct, because you know, producing high quality stuff like that takes money, and as you know, like you said, as there's just a flood of all this rubbish, you know, the cream will rise to the top. So talk to me a little bit about brand safety and your view on that, because something that the big boys can do that a lot of us smaller players can't is that they can do what's called programmatic buying, where you just buy on a large scale and it's all controlled algorithmically via and you know, a computer. But what has been happening, you've had some very famous faux pas where you've had, you know, wholesome brands like Disney and they'll have an ad or video roll, you know, pop up on a KKK site or something like that, just or on a porn site that's just really unwholesome. And so this has put the creators of the content and the platforms like Facebook and Google kind of at odds, because of course Facebook and Google, they're like, oh, that's an algorithm problem and we're on it, but we really can't control it and blah blah blah. And it's like, look, you guys have made billions and billions of dollars off of other people's content. And now that you're having an issue where their brands are being damaged by some of this, you know, placement, now you're saying that it's the algorithm's fault. So where do you stand on brand safety? Like, is it Facebook and Google's, do they have a higher level of responsibility, or do you feel that irrespective of what an algorithm does, brand safety is always the responsibility of the business owner?
Well, I think that there's a contract probably in there somewhere about where you can show these brand elements and where you can't. That's usually right. Very standard in any of this, you know, online advertising and online distribution of content. And because, you know, brands like Disney, we know, are for children, and we don't necessarily want to show that. But what's more dangerous is the brands that may be more edgy, you know, let's say cigarettes, you know, they're not advertising the way they used to because everyone's like cut that off, right? And alcohol and things like that. But I think the platforms that are distributing that content or being a distributing channel, they own the responsibility to really police their own algorithms, to really be careful, and the mechanism behind that to make sure that they're, you know, quote unquote, firing correctly. The brand doesn't understand the technology. What they understand is, like, we want to get our message out there. We're paying for it. We rely on you to actually get it into the right place. And I think there should be some, you know, maybe some penalties associated to that not happening the way it was expected in that contract.
Mm-hmm. I tend to agree, because if, especially like you said, when you're talking about them elephant dollars, because programmatic is not cheap. Like you're talking minimum in some of these buys, like minimum $10 million. And then you turn around and tell me that, you know, it was the algorithm's fault. Like that's just not going to fly. So last question, and I'll let you get back to your day, and I do appreciate you taking the time. It's a modified version of the last question that John Lee Dumas asked on his Entrepreneur on Fire podcast, but I'm steering it in a very particular direction, and I want you to understand why I'm asking it the way that I'm asking it. So in my personal and professional opinion, there's a gap in the digital marketing education space in terms of career trajectory. And by professional, I mean someone who works in-house at a brand or an agency. I'm not referring to digital entrepreneurship, solopreneurs, someone like a John Lee Dumas or Pat Flynn, even though you could absolutely make the case that they're pros because they operate at such a high level. It's not who I'm talking about. I'm talking about people with jobs, folks who get a W-2 or a 1099 at the end of the year. So just in terms of professionalizing oneself in digital marketing, there's sort of three main tracks. The first is to just, you know, Google it, which there is a lot of merit there. There's a lot of good content out there, much of it for free. However, contrary to popular belief, rooting it out does take a degree of skill on the searcher's part. You might land on convince and convert. You might end up doing Amway. Like who knows where that Google rabbit hole goes? You can do what I did, which is go get a degree in internet marketing. However, that's very expensive. I had to borrow the better part of $60,000 to get my degree. Plus, it's time consuming, because even though my degree degree program was accelerated, it still took 30 months to complete. But by far, the most prevalent way that people educate themselves and disseminate best-in-class practices is through conferences and seminars. The cons there is that even though in aggregate, it's a lot less expensive than a degree program, you have to have that money up front. So take some of your better conferences like a South by Southwest or Social Media Marketing World. You're looking at between $500 and $1,500 just to get through the door. That does not include your flight, your hotel, Uber back and forth, eating out for however many days. After you factor all of that other stuff back in, you're easily looking at between $3,000 and $5,000 on a single conference. And sometimes at some of the conferences like a ClickFunnels, you have a VIP coaching program / inner circle, whatever you want to call it, and those can be upwards of $10,000. So even though in aggregate, you know, $15,000 is a lot less than $60,000, you got to have that $15,000 up front. Like there's no financial aid. And so what I'm trying to do is I'm trying to crowdsource, if you will, a way of professionalizing yourself that does not include rolling the dice on Google, selling your firstborn to the Department of Education, or having to mortgage your house so that you can afford a conference. So now that I'm done rambling for however many minutes, I'll ask the actual question, which is, imagine you woke up in a brand new world, identical to Earth, but you knew no one. You still have all the experience, skill, and knowledge you currently have, your food and shelter taken care of, but all you have is a laptop and no money. That's right. You are college freshman broke, Gene. You got somewhere to lay your head, a meal plan, computer Wi-Fi, and that's it. How would you build relationships with industry thought leaders over the next 30 days by working for free?
And I mean, it really is, the answer is right there in your question. The thought leaders are out there. They want to be known and seen, right? They're easy to find in every industry because they're thought leaders. They're the ones that are producing content. They're the ones that are writing and producing videos. So I would reach out to them specifically knowing that they're looking to get their content distributed out into new channels. And there's a huge opportunity, I think, for anyone who's already creating content. This goes for brands or individual thought leaders like a John Lee Dumas or Pat Flynn, both buddies of mine. I think that you could literally take content that's being created today and offer your services to help them get that into different channels and really increase the distribution of that and let them see how you've done this using that. If you did it for free for a month, that they're going to want to pay you to keep doing that, especially if you can track the results. I've talked about that in the very beginning. Tracking results, very important. Like, here's some new views that we've gotten. We're going to put some new things to track this on there. I'd like to work with you to make sure that this is working. And I would pick three or four people and really go heavy into that and help them get their content that's already being created into new channels and help them get new opportunities develop from that, and then let them pay you a monthly fee pretty quickly. And you don't have to pay, you know, invest all the money to do that. You just have to take a playbook and start to develop that by working with these very focused thought leaders and pick one industry. Don't try to spread yourself too thin. That's my take.
Absolutely. I love it. Gene, this has been tremendous. Please take a moment. Tell us about your podcast, Leaders in the Trenches. Tell us about all your social media handles, your new book coming out in September. Where can we get some more of you?
So this is the chance where I get to dance, right?
That's right.
So if you want to go check out the podcast, Leaders in the Trenches, sometimes people would say, you know, how do you spell that? How many S's and all that stuff? If you just want to go to GeneGeneTheDanceMachine.com, and that does work, that'll take you right into my podcast where I've interviewed, I want to say 270, 280 different entrepreneurs, best-selling authors, speakers. A lot of the people we talked about today are people I would call personal friends of mine that have been on the show. And that's one place. Of course, you can find me on Twitter at Gene Hammett or find me on Facebook. And, you know, my business is around turning everyday entrepreneurs into forces of nature. And if you're looking to understand speaking opportunities, I've got a kind of a checklist. If you want to go get something completely for free, just go to GeneHammett.com/checklist. And it'll give you the insights behind getting on stages, because that's where you met me, right, Timo, at Sage.
Right. That's where
I share some insights about how I do that on a regular basis. I'm speaking at a marketing conference in a few weeks in Minnesota. I'm speaking at, you know, other marketing conferences throughout the country. So if you want to figure out how to raise your authority, that's what I'm really best at. And you can check me out in those places. And the book, you know, I feel like I got a mouthful here, but I've built all these things systematically to build my own platform and raise awareness, but also to share back information. I put a lot into this book. I mentioned to you about my story of building everything up and losing everything and looking back about the trap of success. So the name of the book is The Trap of Success. And it's really about finding your significance in the world, your work and life. And I missed that opportunity, but I ended up finding it when I lost everything. So I share back kind of that story and some insights along that journey. You can find the details there at trapofsuccess.com, and that'll be coming out in September. You can pre-order that if you sign up. Get you a couple of extra chapters on that, and from there we can just go. Just reach out to me, ask me anything.
There you have it, folks. Trapofsuccess.com, genehammett.com/list. Was that correct?
Genehammett.com/cheat sheet.
And yeah, man, as you just heard, the man knows his stuff and he has a tremendous story to share. That was, you know, gut-wrenching having being cheated like that, but you know, has the intestinal fortitude to keep it going. Real strong relationship. So we salute you, we commend your wife. Thank you so much for taking the time. This has been awesome.
Fantastic to be here.
If you've enjoyed this episode of the Marketing Disenchanted podcast, consider becoming a patron at patreon.com/marketingdisenchanted. Your support helps with hosting the audio files, upgrading audio equipment, and so much more. And between you and me, my pledge levels are killing them. If you go look at other people's pledges and come back and look at mine, I'm a professional marketer, so you know I like my swag. I got t-shirts, USB thumb drives, not to mention my awesome products. So go to patreon.com for. Thank you for doing me the high honor of listening to the very end. Please subscribe in iTunes, Stitcher, or your favorite podcasting app. Leave a 5-star rating and write a review telling people about my unmitigated awesomeness. It really helps out with getting the show shown. Follow me on Twitter at Tembo8482. That's T-E-M-B as in boy, O-8482.
Please hang up and try again.